Although, let's be perfectly candid, being one of the most respected journalists in America is a low bar. But what an honor to be back here among friends and the spirits of friends. I'm so grateful to Chancellor Bob Coombe, to everyone involved in this really terrific idea, this program to connect us old people to the thrilling life that we all shared here, the life of the mind. And I hope that everyone will still feel good about the decision to invite me 45 minutes from now. When I was a high school senior in the suburbs of Denver, I made a promise to myself that I was going to go to college as far away from home as I could get. And I made it 12 miles. I had these great dreams of going off to some exotic place like Washington, D.C. And one night I shared those dreams with my father at dinner, and he answered in words that I will never forget. "Son," he said, "you can go to any school in the world that you can pay for." And just about that same time, a really unexpected thing happened, an amazingly lucky stroke in a long series of lucky strokes that have made up my life. I'm the luckiest man I've ever met. I won the same scholarship that my smarter, older sister had used to attend the University of Denver, and so I came down here. Mom told me that I could pretend that I lived far away, and except for when I had a lot of laundry, then I could pretend to live close. And so I moved my things into the 9th floor of the old Centennial Towers, where I was matched up with a roommate from New York, very sophisticated sophomore, who asked a few minutes after we met if it would be all right if his girlfriend shared our room. So my first memories of DU involved these very envious hours spent killing time in the hallway. And eventually, after a couple of weeks, they moved out. They got a house over on High Street. And this was the late 1970s. This sort of thing doesn't go on anymore. But you might not be surprised that 2 days later, he stopped by the room to ask if he had left his large bag of cocaine in the dresser, which he had. So we got that straightened out. And I won't tell you about roommate number two. We'll leap ahead to the end of my first year, by which time I had begun to meet the friends and professors, and in many cases, these were the same people who would come to shape my life. I'm tempted to go in a number of different directions tonight, because so much of what I am, I owe to this place and its people. The people, most of all, because let's be frank, until recent years, the place was a dump. But the people. One reason I've been lucky enough to make my living doing what I love is that I was taught at the University of Denver how to write. It happened one specific summer. I was making up some of the credits that I had to drop when I was serving as editor of the Clarion during my junior year, and I enrolled in a summer course called, I think it was called Philosophical Writing, and it was taught by a professor named Frank Seeberger in the philosophy department, who at that time in his life reminded me very much of Donald Sutherland in Animal House. And Frank, at that stage of his career, he's a brilliant man, And I owe so much to him. But at that stage in his career, he was in a phase where he did not believe in grades. He felt they were a tyranny and a repressive of the educational system. And this made him insanely popular as a teacher. And so we all walked into the basement of the old philosophy department and gathered around a table, and Frank said that he only wanted people, he didn't believe in grades. Everybody was going to get an A. So he only wanted the people who really wanted to do the work. So everybody got up and left. And there were about three of us who were still sitting there out of just dumb curiosity, see what would happen next. And Frank passed out a three-page mimeograph, double-spaced paper and said, this is the reading for the course. It's getting better and better. He said, we're not going to meet. I know it says in the catalog that we're going to meet three times a week, but we're not going to meet at all. Just put that in there so it could be, you know, a three-credit hour course. Your assignment is to go home, read the reading, which was this thick, and write one paragraph summarizing what is in the paper. Turn it into me on Friday, leave it in my box. Come back on Monday, it'll be graded. When you're done with it, you're finished for the summer. All right, well, I was the editor of the Clarion. I could tell this was not going to take long for me to knock that out of the park. So I set that aside, and on Thursday night, took it out, started reading it, discovered it was a passage from the philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein, talking about the difference between ordinal numbers, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and cardinal numbers, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th. All right, so I read that through and rolled some paper into the typewriter, started typing. Ludwig Wittgenstein, parentheses 1873 to 1937, or whatever his years are, was an Austrian philosopher, blah, blah, blah. And when I had a paragraph full of bullshit, that looked pretty good. I turned it into Frank's mailbox and on Monday went and picked it up. And my little sheet of paper was stapled to, as I recall, about 8 pages of single-spaced typewritten commentary on my paragraph. At the end of which, Frank had written, try again. So I went home, I reread the paper, filed it again, got the same thing back. Maybe it was just 6 pages of commentary the second week. But this went on for 4 or 5 or 6 weeks through the summer, writing this paragraph over and over. And then Frank would spend his whole weekend commenting on it. And finally, I went to the department. I knocked on his door. He waved me in, sat down. We started talking about the difference between ordinal and cardinal numbers. We talked all afternoon. But finally, a light bulb went off in my head, and for a few minutes, I got the difference. I'm sorry, I don't remember it. I can't share it with you now. But I had it for those few minutes, and I ran back to my apartment. I typed up that paragraph. It was infinitely better than what I had done before. I turned it in and came back on Monday and was finished with the class. What did I learn? You can't write well about something that you don't understand, right? What a gift that was. That same summer, I remember I earned the most meaningful honor of my career. I don't expect ever to get a more meaningful one. English majors will understand this. I got an A+ from Gerald Chapman. The walking embodiment, personification of intellectual rigor and scholarship. I fell in love, had my heart broken. Yeah, all the lessons, I believe for about 17 minutes one night that summer, I had the whole meaning of life figured out. Maybe you had nights like that when you were here. But rather than talk all evening about the great stories of DU, learning how to live, and what I owe to this place, I thought I'd talk for a few minutes about the life we're living through now, at least really all of us, the change we're living through, a change that's going on, hanging everywhere about us like dust in the air, so much so that we hardly even notice it, a change which, in a weird kind of way, I've come to connect in retrospect with a mystery that I encountered here. And if you'll indulge me, I'll try to explain this. I got to DU with really no clear idea what I wanted to do with my life. I had a lot of ambition, but very hazy. I could picture a future involving, you know, enormous power, noble achievements of some kind, a yacht. I remember the yacht was a part of it. But gradually, these experiences with teachers, with great teachers, in the intimate kind of way that DU provides that, began to shape who I would become. And I became an English major, as Bob said. And the more classes that I took, the more amazed I was by the caliber of these teachers at DU. And then another one of these lucky things happened to me, and I got a scholarship to go to graduate school in English at a great university. And I was stunned when I got there and nobody knew anything about these people who had taught me at DU. So I would sit up in these conversations with these graduates of Harvard and Yale and Princeton and Oxford and Cambridge and try to explain to them that there was this man, John Williams, at the University of Denver who was among the world's greatest living novelists. And the fact that they hadn't heard of him didn't change his greatness. The fact that all but one of his novels were out of print didn't change it. The fact that you couldn't find his books at the DU bookstore didn't change it. I failed to convince them of that, but I do feel good about the fact that the New York Times recently acknowledged John's genius. His book, Stoner, was written up in the Times Book Review as, quote, something rarer than a great novel, a perfect novel. So well told and beautifully written, so deeply moving that it takes your breath away. Okay, that's the kind of review you want, really, as a writer. Yeah, John Williams. And I would talk about the groundbreaking work on mythology that was being done by Bob Richardson and Bert Feldman, the same Bob Richardson who recently won the Bancroft Prize, one of the most prestigious prizes in academia. And I would explain that Jerry Chapman was the greatest teacher of Shakespeare imaginable, and try to convince them that whatever they were learning about T.S. Eliot at Oxford, it was not as compelling as hearing Ed Twining read Prufrock. And it just didn't compute, because all this happened back in what you might call, or what I might call, the age of experts. American culture, the culture I grew up in and came of age in, was very much organized for technical and economic and government regulatory reasons, for a lot of reasons I won't go into. You'll be relieved to hear. Organized into these strict hierarchies, and people gained credibility in the culture by getting to the top of one of these hierarchies. The first one I remember, the first rigid hierarchy of American life back then, was Dad. It's the one I miss the most. But when I grew up, all temper tantrums had to be finished before Dad walked through the door. And our faces needed to be washed and cleaned, and we needed to be all calm and ready to greet Daddy and get out of his way while he read his newspaper. The family was a hierarchy. Then we discovered a little later that Dad was living in his own hierarchy. Maybe you remember the the first time that dad's boss came to dinner when you were a kid, and the house had to be clean in a whole way that it had never been cleaned before, and the kids had to be coached in a way we had never been coached before. How many of those great 60s sitcoms revolved around the boss coming to dinner? You know, it was a big deal. I've been a dad and a boss today, and let me tell you, it's not like that anymore. And all along, there was Walter Cronkite on the television set, you know, telling everybody 22 minutes, the 22 minutes of what mattered in the world that day. And we all shared it. We all took in exactly the same agenda and priorities from this trusted figure, who was the trusted figure because he had reached the top of CBS, which was the top of the television hierarchy. A hierarchy of Hollywood studios made movies featuring an official pantheon of Hollywood stars. You know, you'd see these crazy things where, you know, Rex Harrison would be a cowboy in this movie or something. The casting never made sense, but those were the stars. Detroit had all American car buyers siloed into hierarchies. They knew us, and they sold us our cars. There were Ford people, Lincoln people, Buick people, Cadillac people. My family were Chevy people when we were paying our own money, and Oldsmobile people when Dad was getting a company car. In my line of work, the press, it was the New York Times, the Washington Post, at the top of the newspaper pile. Time and the New Yorker were at the top of the weekly magazine pile, had the most credibility. So why didn't that world know about all this incredible teaching that was going on at this underfunded, scrappy little dump of a place in Southeast Denver? Well, because there was an academic hierarchy. Harvard and Yale and Princeton. We see vestiges of it today in these magazine rankings of the most important schools. And the most brilliant scholars in the world had almost no chance to be recognized for their brilliance until they had reached the top of these hierarchies. And some very mediocre people could be celebrated as brilliant if they happened to be there, by the way. The best thing you could say about that mid-century culture of hierarchies was that, at least in the United States, they weren't passed down necessarily generation to generation. There was a quality of merit in who got to the top. All an ambitious, talented person had to do was sign on to the values and culture of the hierarchy you were entering. Any person with enough talent and ambition and luck could rise. I feel like I'm one of the last examples of that. The problem, though, was the huge number of people, equally as smart and diligent and talented, who didn't want to get into those hierarchies for whatever reason. Maybe they wanted to live in a place where you can see the sky come all the way down to the ground. Maybe they liked a little peace and quiet. Maybe they loved someone who loved a smaller place. There were a lot of reasons to live in a place like Denver or Portland or Tulsa or Missoula, but it generally meant working on the downslope of these peaks. No matter how smart or diligent or honorable these men and women might be, it was next to impossible in those days for them to achieve broad influence and credibility across the culture. Well, today, those hierarchies are in collapse. The power of digital communication to break down these hierarchies and erase physical borders is only beginning to be understood, and people are only beginning to grapple with both the positive and negative implications of it. The impact of the digital revolution is just beginning to ripple out from that first shattering stone that's been hurled into the glassy pond of the old order. I won't even begin to catalog all the effects. You'll figure them out in your own lives, but I'll just note a few of them. I'll start with my business, where the greatest empires of the old top-down order are now competing head-to-head with solo practitioners sitting in the dens of the living rooms of their houses. It's not unusual in this presidential campaign we're living through for a YouTube video to attract more viewers than the most popular news shows on cable TV or even the networks. A blogger can just as easily break an influential story as I can at Time Magazine. A month ago, I was in St. Paul listening to the speeches at the Republican National Convention, and speaker after speaker hammered on an offhand remark by Barack Obama last spring to the effect that working class voters cling to their guns and religion. Now, that wasn't a line that came from the New York Times. That wasn't certified by the Washington Post. It was a line captured by an enterprising gal with a tape recorder and a blog. Now, I know writers at major publications who now spend more time reading anonymous comments attached to our online articles than they do listening to members of Congress or studying journals of opinion. The hierarchy of how you get your ideas across and find influence in the marketplace of ideas is completely shattered. But it's not just my life that's been flattened by the decline of hierarchies. I happen to live in a neighborhood now full of doctors, which is very handy because I've told the kids, if Daddy ever collapses in the yard, just run to any house across the street and ring the doorbell. All I hear them talk about is how their lives are being changed by the internet. Patients used to come into their offices to hear the voice of God. And now they come in with their detailed information on their symptoms. They've already diagnosed themselves. They've chosen the medicine they want to go on, and the frequency of dosage. They'd like to talk about alternative therapies and centers of treatment. My dad's generation, the goal was to go to work for one company at age 22 and leave that company 40 years later with a gold watch and a pension. That is completely flattened, that hierarchy. Everyone manages or must manage his or her own career, their own education, their own productivity. This election season has been a stunning blow to the old hierarchies. The two most compelling figures of this general election, Barack Obama and Sarah Palin, have completely leapfrogged the establishment of their parties. They have paid virtually no dues in their lives. They have kissed few, if any, rings or anything else on their way up to the top of the heap. Or look at the Wall Street crisis that we're now living through. I cannot think of a more dramatic sign that the hierarchies are rapidly collapsing than the first vote, not today's, but on Monday, in the House of Representatives to kill the Treasury Department's rescue plan. The President wanted the bill. The Secretary of Treasury, the Chairman of the Federal Reserve wanted it, the Speaker of the House, the majority and minority leaders of both houses. Warren Buffett wanted it. Michael Bloomberg wanted it. The Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, the Washington Post, Barack Obama, John McCain all wanted that plan to pass. And it was defeated. Now, exactly how all this has become possible, as I say, we'll talk about at another time or in questions and answers after this. But I think at bottom, there's both a sunny and a dark set of implications to it. The optimist in me says, finally, people can find information, share ideas, and make themselves heard without going through certain locked doors and learning secret passwords of the old hierarchies. That's a good thing. Or as Bob Coombe just said to me at dinner, finally, in the future, universities are going to be judged on what they actually do rather than on reputation or ranking. The pessimist would say that people now have tools to choose only the associates and only the ideas that they want to meet or hear. That they never have to learn to compromise or persuade, they need only to ostracize and do combat. I think there's some truth in both those things. This digital revolution sprays power out indiscriminately as if from a fire hose, and it can divide us just as easily as it can bring us together around the truth. Do I personally like this? Of course not. I'm scared to death by it. You know, I'm a rapidly aging mountaineer who managed to scale one of those old hierarchies, finally reached the top of the old print media business, and here's Mount Vesuvius about to blow. And I do. I spend a lot of time thinking about the rumbling under my feet. But at the same time, I'm excited. I feel like we're reopening the clogged channels of American genius, knocking down some of those locked doors and publishing those secret passwords that I talked about. A bright idea doesn't need a sponsor anymore. The marketplace of American ideas is being transformed almost overnight from a high-end mall dominated by a Nordstrom at one end, Macy's at the other, Williams-Sonoma, Tiffany, Abercrombie and Finch along the way, into a Baghdad marketplace, wild and unregulated, thrilling and extreme. The role of a place like DU in this world somehow manages to remain essentially unchanged and undiminished in this maelstrom. Because more than ever, Americans need a broad, deep education to navigate this world without hierarchies. If you find yourself in the Baghdad market, you had better be a smart consumer. In the future, no authority is going to filter your news for you or dictate government policies or choose your health care. There'll be no Benjamin Spock telling a whole generation of mothers exactly how to raise their kids. There'll be no record labels choosing the music you listen to. There'll be no network bosses dictating your TV schedule, what you watch, or when you watch it. We're taking the helm of our own lives, and we've got to learn how to steer them. When I think back on 4 happy years at the University of Denver, I am most grateful for the fact, the blessing, that here I was taught how to steer. Thank you.